I, by the way, went to high school with the person who invented the Abbott. Bill Warner. Mm-hmm. He won a Scientific Academy Award for it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Could you tell back then that he was destined for it?
He was one of those AV people in high school, and I was the editor of the yearbook. He was the photographer. When video cameras became inexpensive, he bought one of those editing systems that was all linear, and he said, this is really silly, and being an MIT graduate, he decided to invent something that made it much better, and he did.
The first cut. I'll just teach you simple cuts to start with.
Welcome back to Craft Check. In the cut, we're here with Lisa Zeno Churgin, Academy nominated editor.
The thing that was very interesting about Cider House was from just the dailies, the Miramax was concerned that they weren't getting enough from Toby's performance, just seeing the dailies. And he was actually having people say to him, you need to give more, we need to see more of it on screen. And then from the very first time the producer saw it put together, he actually turned to me and said, where did you find this stuff?
We never saw this with the dailies.
Right, well, the thing is that
it's not in context though.
Yes, but also finding those moments, finding those small things. His performance was very subtle, but I loved it. And at the end of each week, Lasse, I would give Lasse a cut of everything that I had done that week. And so Lasse was able to tell while they were shooting that it was everything was fine because he was seeing the material cut together.
Gattica.
Oh my goodness.
Oh man, I was so excited when I was in film school because this is one of the top films that my professor was super excited about showing us.
Oh yeah?
There's a lot of green imagery when things are going crazy in Gattica, like the light turns green or there's this type of glow happening when things are out of control and the camera starts shaking and, you know, when they're running away from the club,
mm-hmm.
such like that. One of those scenes that I really love is when I think they're back at her house and you see the waves coming in from the ocean, which is a big theme in the film as well.
It's uh-huh.
always by the ocean.
Right.
But it's upside down.
I know.
And then it comes in and they're, you know, they're having a good time there, and but it's completely upside down, so you're...
I know.
Is that intentional?
I had... Well, oh, totally. The director and the DP, Slavik, who was European, had no need to explain things the way Americans like to have things explained. And his use of color, he worked on those films, I think it was Red and Blue, I don't know whether or not, with a French filmmaker. So he was, he brought that use of really concentrated colors.
You know, everything from the sets to the costumes to, you know, the way that the camera's moving is so precise and everything
yes.
is so clean and industrial looking.
And restrained.
Septic.
Everything and then, is very restrained.
So when there's the moment where they're breaking the rules and mm-hmm. being illegal or whatever,
yes.
it's that's mm-hmm. when kind of everything goes crazy. Her hair's flying
uh-huh.
and the camera's shaking as they're running and there's this crazy green light and it's, so I think it's cool because it's almost necessary. It's almost mm-hmm. like another film happening.
Well, it totally worked then for you, which is great. That's exactly what the, you know, what he wanted.
Intense discussion of Dead Man Walking.
Ah, Dead Man Walking.
Oh. Oh, man.
There's a new movie now called Dead Man Down, or, you know, I mean, it's...
But not the same thing. Just...
Oh, no, no, no.
Oh, okay.
No. No, there's... They apparently say that.
So Dead Man Walking is actually based on a true story.
Correct. Sister Helen Prejean was a, I'm forgetting the name. It's a very specific term when somebody chooses to have sort of a confidant, a confessor, when they have been convicted and sentenced to death and want to have somebody to talk to. And so it was based on her experience of two different people. I think her book was based on two people.
And I think that was also Tim Robbins' almost debut as a director as well.
Bob Roberts, which I had also done with him, was his first movie. Dead Men Walking was his first sort of very traditional film.
And for a first-time traditional filmmaker, he got a lot of praise for it. It was just amazing, and what he had the actors emote.
He had two, I call them thoroughbreds or Arabians. You know, a lot of actors are, you've got your actors who learn their part, they practice it in front of the mirror, and they'll give you the same performance over and over and over again. And then you have your Sean Penn, Susan Sarandon, Dustin Hoffman, Michael Caine, people that I've had Ben Kingsley, I've had the opportunity to work with. They'll give you something different. So in the 8 takes that they did for the confession scene in Dead Man Walking, there were different levels of intensity, and they were like anemones. There's a dance that they do. And I think that in that particular situation, we actually shot A and B camera, which, because you're gonna have somebody giving so much and an actor receiving and giving back, you really need to have the temperature of the performance be the same. And Sean Penn, in that confession scene, he cried like in take 2 and 3, and then was probably a little spent, and then maybe once more towards the end. And that's, you have two thoroughbreds doing a dance together.
Oh, that's awesome. The one film that kind of stands out for me that is kind of the black sheep would be Priest.
Ah.
I mean, that's up my alley. I love that stuff. But it just seems so out of place in mm-hmm. everything else that you've done. And I was like, she probably got badass one day and was just like, give me something crazy with zombies in it or something. So what happened?
Vampires.
So vampires, yeah.
Right, zombies are the other choice. I really wanted to do something against type. You get stereo, you know, you get really put in a niche. When you edit, she does drama, she does comedies, she does action, she does, you know, and unfortunately it's mostly men who do the action in big visual effects movies. So I wanted to have the opportunity to work on a big visual effects movie so that nobody could say she can't do visual effects. You know, it's had like over 800 visual effects. Oh, we had a scene in that film where it was actually, some of the second unit was filmed so differently from principal photography that they had to go back and reshoot a scene. And I had the opportunity to work with the storyboard artist because they really wanted to spend as little as possible going back and reshooting. It was when the priestess, when the motorcycles are coming towards her and she does all these big anti-gravity defying things. And they originally had a big, huge rig, like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, where people do all these things, but they weren't going to set it up again. So we had to figure out really nuts and bolts how we could do it. And the storyboard artist came into my room and we said, okay, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this? And he would draw a shot. What, these are the shots that we need. We would scan it. We would put it into the Avid and we created a scene and then we would put it on my laptop. We'd go to the set and show it to the director and he'd go, okay, this is just like storyboarding something. So I had an opportunity to do that a few times. That was really, really fun.
And actually put it in the sequence.
Well, yes, and then they went and shot it based on what we came up with in just through storyboards and, you know, cutting them together.
So you gave us an inside look at a lot of our favorite movies. So thank you very much for coming by.
Oh, you're welcome. It was a pleasure being here.